welcome to the worship place of Presbyterian Church in Norwood. And last week that I shared the image of the today's church, one of the images can be the Noah's Ark. And I think that very image compels us to engage in Christian practice of radical acceptance of a very differences and diversity that we have. And so Presbyterian Church in North is an open and welcoming multi-ethnic congregation. English worship is offered at 10 a.m. and Korean worship is offered at 12 p.m. in this very place. So no matter where you are from and no matter who you are and no matter where your spiritual journey is, you are welcome. I know some of us believe in God sometimes, some of the times, and I know some of us believe in God none of the time, and perhaps some of us believe in God all the time, but it doesn't matter. Come with your question, come with your story, and with your hope and even fears. Let us all lay down and share so that we may be able to engage in God's ministry. So worship is a time for us to be refreshed and renewed with the meaning and purpose in our life. And for that matter, whether you are young, very young like Daniel, or if you are elderly, elderly like Dorothy, who is over 90, you are all welcome. This is God's place. And so, brothers and sisters, come, let us worship God.
Good morning. Please rise if you're able and join me in the call to worship. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth.
We will tell to the coming generation
the glorious deeds of the Lord and the wondrous God has wrought.
Let us worship God. We will sing hymn number 263, verses 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you.
gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in penitence and faith, we renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. Let us confess our sins in silence. Ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Believe in the good news of Jesus Christ.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Sit with your parents,
We will greatly appreciate it.
Please join me in a prayer for illumination. Meet us in this moment of proclamation, God.
Enlighten us with your spirit.
Motivate us with your word.
Remind us of your commands.
Challenge us to live your way.
Hold us accountable.
Be more than sing and pray.
In Christ, amen.
Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verses 28-37. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, with him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. survey, excuse me, the researcher asked this question to people of age 60 and over. If you could live your life over again, what would you do differently? And the following are what people answered. They said, I would wax the floor less and listen to people more. I would invite more friends and share life stories and loving support for one another, and concerns less how much I make. I would cry and laugh more with my family and spend less time watching TV. I would savor the little moments of life and pick up joy and the true lessons that life offers. I would say more of I love you, thank you, I'm sorry, and less bragging about myself. So I ask you this morning, if you could live your life over again, what would you do differently? In seeking for excitement in life, some people seek hyper-stimulation, often being indulged by social media filled with provocative images and content. And in searching for what is called mountaintop experience, some have traveled on a pilgrimage of hiking the long trail of Santiago in Spain and walking over 200 miles of a soul-searching journey. Some young people these days, they plunge into extreme sports like cliff jumping or sky jump or bungee jump or, you know, all kinds of those extreme sports. In looking for the spiritual high, in a heightened state to entertain themselves, many people seek sensationalism and something that excites them and take them to the top of the emotional roller coaster. It is not so difficult to see this kind of cultural trend in America. One evidence would be the fact that how much Americans love different kind of reality shows. I may have some old shows like Survivors. You probably have heard of it or watched it. I'm wondering about Kardashians. Not your kind of taste, but I'm sure some people did. American Idol, I love to watch that. The Real Housewives of New York City, or The Apprentice, I used to watch that, some of that. And The Temptation Island, or Fear Factor, or recently Below That. I haven't watched it, but I found it from the list of the popular TV, reality TV shows. And all these reality TV shows, in my opinion, serves in some degree as a kind of emotional pornography, because they secretly satisfy people's fantasy and their unorthodox desires that often our society would not sanction in normal circumstances. However, one way to live our life more fully, positively, and with energy is to find something extraordinary from the very ordinary things in our daily lives. This requires training our spiritual eyes, focus on the blessings that are often hidden in daily life. Finding God's blessings, like from what many today's teenagers would protest, it's like boring, nothing happens. Or even from the times of trials and sufferings, even pain in our daily lives. What truly matters is that if we can find something special from everyday life context and discover its meanings and lessons of life, I think then the mountaintop experience is not far away from our reach. Today's passage describes the transfiguration of Jesus Christ on the mountaintop. It was truly a kind of once-in-a-lifetime experience, a multi-sensory experience that was visually provocative and intense, and profoundly touching and transformative to those people who are actually experiencing this phenomenon. Theologically, this experience of the mountaintop transfiguration of Jesus is very significant because for the people of Jew, they believed that Elijah, the great prophet who was taken into heaven, would come before their Messiah comes. The appearance of Elijah bears the kind of preview shows in the theater before the feature presentation. If you survey the Gospel of Luke, both the baptism of Christ, which is recorded in chapter 3, and the mountaintop experience of transfiguration of Jesus Christ in chapter 9, these are the defining moments, a kind of critical hinge moment before Jesus Christ jumping into his public ministry as the Messiah. The transfiguration of Jesus is truly a defining moment to announce Jesus as the Messiah. And truly, it was. This incredible experience for Jesus' disciples was so overwhelming that they want to keep it within their small sensory or cognitive sort of container. They want to keep it for a long time because this is so special. It's almost like, I don't know, when some people, I don't know, these days, you know, one of the K-pop group, the Blackpink, I don't know how many of you heard of the girl idol group Blackpink. Recently they had in Chicago their show and 75,000 people showed up, and even walking through and touching tip of their hand, you know, their reaction is like getting 1,000 volt of electricity running through your hand, and they wouldn't even wash their hand because they want to preserve somehow that kind of mountaintop experience from their point of view. And so the disciples, they want to contain this experience just like a little boy sometimes blind protest, like covering his eyes with small palm of his hand and said, I cannot see the sky. But just because he covers his eyes and claims it, I cannot see the sky stopped existing. This reminds me of a story when the Native Americans, when they first saw vastness of the Pacific Ocean, they did not know how to deliver or how to describe, how to communicate their unbelievable experience to their tribes. So they wanted to carry ocean water in a small leather container. But soon they realized that carrying the salty water would not fully describe this multi-sensory awesome experience they had, the full scale of these aspects of the experience. The container was just too small to convey their overwhelming experience when they first saw the vast Pacific Ocean before their naked eyes. Isn't this what we sometimes try to do when we have a mountaintop experience of our own, in whatever form that is? And we just try to contain it within the workable framework of our own rationale, our own like a belief, our own familiar tradition and container. We sometimes try to collapse the richness and the vastness of this God appearing to us, or God saying something to us deeply in our heart, into a little container of rationalism. Indeed, this is what the Apostle Peter tried to do. He wanted to contain God's amazing, marvelous sort of plan for salvation for all humankind within the framework of his own Jewish understanding. So he wanted to build a dwelling, three dwellings, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and Jesus Christ, and keep them there so that you can just keep them in your heart. The important question is, what is the significance of having this kind of mountaintop experience? What is the point, and why God sometimes allowed us to have that encounter in our life? The first point is that mountaintop experience is essential for our spiritual renewal and our spiritual growth. All human beings, including all of us, have a particular worldview that was largely constructed by our society and our particular culture. But God has a full comprehension, the comprehensive view about our life, about our society, and God's whole creation. In the mountaintop experience, we finally see, aha, this was what truly means. Did you have that realization? After some time later, that was what it was meant. And this is what God truly wants me to do with my life. We finally put the missing pieces of life riddles into a whole comprehensible perspective. And this kind of mountaintop experience often serves as a foundation and a pivotal ground for renewing of our Christian identity, and sometimes renewing of my identity as a husband or a father or someone in our community. Second point is that even though you'd love to dwell as long as you can, but you cannot live on the mountaintop forever. You've got to go down to the deep valley with a renewed purpose of life. Peter wanted to make this predictable and containable by building the three dwellings to contain his awesome experience. Just as you cannot cover the entire sky with the small palm of your hand, you cannot contain the mountaintop experience with the physicality of museum, or sometimes however you decorate your home, or even a magnificent cathedral. The significance of having a mountaintop experience is not to try to reciprocate or staying high spiritually, remembering that, recalling that in your memory on the mountaintop, but rather to go down to the valley of everyday life with a renewed sense of purpose. There must be a meaningful connection between mountaintop experience, where we have that deep realization. And this happens sometimes when you sit on your porch or the deck, reading perhaps psalm, or sometimes as in a deep thought, and somehow that you have that new revelatory kind of realization. And then that will change your perspective, somehow your relationship, your purpose in your life. And so there is must be a connection between this mountaintop experience and the life of the valley below, every day, life experience. If the mountaintop represents a place where we are blessed with God's holy presence, then the valley represents a place in our life where you and I must go and share the love of God and engage in the practice of compassion and establishing God's peace and justice in our daily lives. The mountaintop experience is necessary for our spiritual renewal, but going down to the valley is the mandated by Jesus Christ to build God's shalom in our homes, in the community you belong, and in our society. By offering healing, restoring brokenness, alienation, inequality, and any forms of discrimination. It is in the valleys where God's love and mercy must be manifested and made known to other people. And third point is, crisis in our life is often an invitation to a deeper walk with our God. You know, as long as we walk in faith, the shadow of Christ's cross casts upon all areas of our life. Sometimes we want to keep Jesus Christ away from the cross because the cross is a symbol of nothing but a pain and suffering and a symbol of total, catastrophic failure. The disciples of Jesus also kept themselves away from the cross because the cross meant for them the symbol of failure and suffering. However, Moses, Elijah, including God's self, validated Jesus' way of the cross. But Peter didn't want to take part in it because of his own selfishness and his own fear. You know, often when we walk amid crisis and suffering, we can accomplish much more than when we are all okay in normal circumstances. Take the case of Isabella Bamfrey. Some of you know her historically, and she's better known as a Sojourner Truth. When she was sold as a slave to a plantation owner, when she was young, her mother said to her in an offered this prayer, "Dear my Isabella, I don't know what's going to lie ahead of you. People may spit on you, but God is going to carry you. People may throw a stone at you, but God is going to carry you. I don't know what the slave owners will do to you, but Isabella, be strong. And don't lose your hope and your faith, because God is going to carry you through all the way." When young Isabella heard her mom's prayer in tears, she had a mountaintop experience. And because of that, she was able to serve thousands of people, bringing reconciliations beyond hatred, offering hope of thousands of hopeless slaves at the time, and building unity beyond divisions among different races in America. I would like to ask you this question, the same question the researcher asked. What would you do if you could live your life over again? I think for most of us and all of us, we still have more chance to respond to this question. And I truly hope that you would allow yourself to live enough in the mountaintop to receive a new energy, new vision, excavating new sort of meaning and gain perspective in your life. So that you and I, we less consume our life and our energy and resources for meaningless things, for the trivial things. Having mountaintop experience is essential for Christians. But if we want to follow Jesus, we must come down from mountaintop and to the deep valleys, to the foxholes where the spiritual warfare, where the real concrete practice of our faith must take place on our daily basis. Right there in the valleys, many challenges of reality are still waiting for us. Today's world is desperate and calls each one of us to walk into a unique way, our own unique way, so that the love of God can be communicated and experienced. The healing ministry of Christ must continue, and the restoration of hope is achieved even in the face of suffering and despair. You know, when more and more people, they tend to hold on to the mountaintop experience, and some of the very honest Christians, they would like to hold on to the spiritual high experience in their sanctuary, in their home, only the small confined sacred space, and stay spiritually high. The important question that you and I must ask is, if we don't go to the valley, who will? That all God's people say, Amen.
Amen.
Let us join our hymn number 2. Oh, this, we don't have a hymn number there, but Beautiful Savior. Please follow with the lyrics projected on the screen. So I would like first to have a party before us. Kathy was supposed to share this on behalf of the ad hoc committee we formed for this special mission project. You know, fire exists for burning, and so does church exist for mission. So if church doesn't bring mission work, there's no true meaning and value for church's existence. And so this is one way I think we share this very important mission project. So Bonnie.
As many of you know through the emails that have been flying through the past couple of days, our church is a co-sponsor along with Church World Service to resettle the Hamidi family in the United States. And we thank you all for all your donations that have come through already. The Hamidi family was evacuated from Afghanistan in 2021. They spent 2 years in Germany and have now been in temporary housing near New Brunswick for a month. This Friday, they will be moving to Jersey City. We, PCIN, are charged with setting up their apartment with essential furnishings to begin their new lives. The Hamidi family is a mother, father, two sons, and four daughters. They speak no English, but some of the children speak some German from having lived in Germany. The mother and daughters cannot read or write in their own native language, which is Dari. Thank you to everyone who has already donated items for the Hamidi family. This will help us on day one. Our commitment to them is typically for 1 year as we move them toward independent living. So there will be more opportunities to serve. Church World Service required that our church pledge a minimum of $7,500 for the Hamidi family to start their new lives. These funds are sent to Church World Service earmarked for the family, and all disbursements to the family go through CWS, who will be accountable to both us and to the family. Pastor Timothy was quick to apply for a mission grant from Presbytery for our resettlement program, and happily, we were granted the full $7,500 required to begin our journey. Many thanks to Pastor Timothy for his wise stewardship. I know that Lila and Jim Kuhn would be pleased that their generous donation to our church in our Mission Investment Fund will also be used to support this ministry. The steering committee for this mission is comprised of Pastor Timothy, Norm Freiberg, Ann Henschen, Jin Yoon, Carol Golub, and Kathy Milstein. We will keep in touch with Church World Service and the Hamidi family, and will keep the congregation informed about what is needed. We are charged with tasks such as, but not limited to, assistance in school enrollment, enrolling in ESL classes, transportation to job interviews and job training. This may involve driving them or assisting them in navigating public transportation. Help them with grocery shopping and using public transportation to get them there. Supplying clothing as needed. Mentorship, school tutoring, getting a library card, and helping them with conversational English. This is a new mission for our church, and we may hit some bumps along the way, but our church always comes through when others need our help. Feel free to ask any member of the committee any questions you may have as we journey through with the Hamidi family. Timothy and Norm could use some help loading the U-Haul on Thursday morning at 10 a.m. If you are available, please speak with any of the committee members after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Bonnie. The reason that Kathy couldn't be here with us this morning is that Kathy's eldest daughter, Jackie, is in a hospital about to give the birth to her second child. So she is there to support and be with the family. So that's why she couldn't make it this morning. I have another also piece of information. You may see the screen. We have some popular photos. I have this huge Bible before me. And this is like a scavenger hunting kind of thing. And a few weeks ago, Jin, our one of the newest members, was looking through some of the shelves, and he accidentally discovered this Bible. This Bible was presented by the Intermediate Christian Endeavor Society. And this is a large Christian movement right during the Second Great Awakening movement in America, which is about 1830s and 40s. And as you know, the First Great Awakening happens about 1770 era. And that was the Great Awakening of Spiritual Awakening in America. And the Second Great Awakening in America, and it is in the pit of those times, this Bible Society presented this historical Bible to our church, North Presbyterian Church. And this one was printed in 1937 in the heart of Second Great Awakening Movement. So it's almost like 87 some years or 8 years. So 90 years old. And so we are so lucky to find this. And I think session will have discussion how to best display this, maybe in part of our back of our sanctuary or somewhere so that we can cherish this. And so Jin, do you have any something to share about this?
Well, it was a joy, and thank you for allowing me the opportunity to restore.
He restored this. This was in a bad shape. And as you see, all those the damaged part, he restored and put all this metal protection on the edge, and you apply special oil to bring it back.
Yeah, I applied linseed oil, and I re-gilded the pages, basically tried my best to bring it back to its original condition.
Thank you. This is something that we can cherish for a long time. So thank you. Any other church announcement? Joys and concern then. Any joys and concern?
Well, continued prayers for the folks in Hawaii, particularly Lanai and the folks that
thank
there's
you.
Still hundreds that they haven't
unaccounted for.
Unaccounted for.
Thank you. Any other? Yes, Thomas.
It is my great joy to announce that we recently added 62 years to our marriage.
Oh. 52 or 62?
62.
That is a milestone achievement. You are the only third couple in my life who reached 60 plus. That is awesome. Thank you. Any other joys and concerns? Yes, Bonnie.
We have a blessing of backpacks on September 11th, but some schools in the country have already gone back. And teachers and students, bless them all, as they start the next year's journey.
Yes, let us remember all our teachers and students as they begin their new academic journey. Thank you. Any other joys and concerns? Yes, Frank.
Yeah, going back to the integrity, what you did in your sermon last week, but I feel sorry for a lot of people that have to endure this crime, especially in inner cities. And immigrants get involved with it as well. Just this rampant crime. And the lunacy that's added to that, if just imagine government officials in Chicago actually suing a car manufacturer, Hyundai and Kia, blaming them for carjackings because of they didn't add some feature to the car. I mean, it's lunacy. No one takes responsibility. People have to endure this, and then they blame others. It's really not right. I feel sorry for people. I really do.
Thank you, Sherry. Any other Let us join together in prayer. Let us pray. God, here and now, we bow our heads and bring our hearts closer to you. For you are the one who flung the stars into the sky. You are the one who filled the oceans with water. And according to the Gospel of John, you are the one who covers us in prayer. Trusting in that goodness, we bring you our deepest joy and concerns today. To start graciously, God, we pray for our planet, our earth. Thank you for the beauty of the mountains and rivers. Thank you for the gift of animals and sunrises. We cannot imagine our life without the beauty of your creation. So in the same breath, we ask that you would draw near to the place where your creation cries out. Draw near to the forest fires in Canada, the hurricane off on the California shore, and the burnt remains still remain in Hawaii, Maui, and creation is crying out. So this morning, Holy God, we lift the earth to you and all our world in prayer. And then our heart zoom in a bit, and as we ask that you would cover our country in prayer. Loving God, be with the politician and the community leaders with integrity that guide us. Give them generous heart and deep-rooted wisdom. Be with the teachers as they prepare to welcome students back to school and the community centers and nonprofits that continue to care for those who are in need. Sprinkle a spirit of generosity and justice throughout our nation, so that our children's children will know more about just home and just society. Now, once again, we zoom in and ask that you cover this church in prayers. O God, fill people's heart of a Presbyterian church in Norwood with a sense of purpose and belonging. We have found friends here, faith here, education here, purpose here, and for all of that, we give you thanks. However, the church does not exist only for those inside its walls alone. We also exist for those outside these walls. So we ask that you'd inspire us as a community of faith to continue loving our neighbors. Inspire us to reach out to those who are victims of war, especially the Hamidi family from Afghanistan. All 8 members of family are in desperate need and seeking for help. Show us how to be a light on the hill and salt for the earth. And teach us how to become good Samaritans with a concrete love and actions in today's world. Show us how to follow your Holy Spirit in obedient trust wherever you lead us. And finally, listening, God, we zoom in once again and ask that you would cover each of us individually in prayer. Hear our prayers of deep gratitude and overflowing joy, as well as our prayers of grief and side-splitting headaches. Hold our prayers for loved ones and a young mother who are in a hospital at this moment waiting for the birth of her second baby. Hold the prayers for the new school and new relationship. Hold the prayers for the job search, trusting that you will open the doors of opportunities. Hold our prayers for remission and sobriety and even deeper faith. Cover us in prayer like the morning dew. Cover us prayers like a mother covers her child with a warm blanket. Cover us in prayer like the waves cover the shore. Whatever you do, God, just keep covering us in prayer and showing on us, showering on us with your unending grace. For with a grateful heart and zoomed in focus, we return to you once more. With a grateful heart, we pray the word your Son Jesus Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In response to God's gracious guidance and blessings, let us bring our offerings. Peace now and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen.